So we continue with our discussions about the different protocols that are used for communication and networking of Internet of Things. So the next protocol that we are going to cover is the COPE protocol, the full form of which is Constrained Application Protocol. And this protocol is particularly used for web transfer. And web transfer, very similar to the HTTP, but web transfer in the context of constrained networks, resource constrained networks, with nodes which are constrained with respect to different resources, such as limited energy or power supply, limited computational resources, limited communication resources, limited bandwidth environment, and so on. So, COPE is sort of like an HTTP equivalent that can be used in the context of IoT. And the other thing that we have to understand is COPE is strictly speaking a session layer protocol. However, we can also conceive it as an application layer protocol as well. So, in IoT, particularly when we take into consideration the different applications involving machine to machine communication, for example, smart energy, smart environment, you know, building automation, and these kind of applications, COPE comes out to be very much useful. COPE is based on a request response model, and so basically, you know, so it will be very clear shortly about how COPE works. So at this point, you know, we have to understand that there are two endpoints, the source and the destination. And a request is sent and a response is received back from the other endpoint, that means the destination. So this is how COPE works. And so there is sort of like a client server kind of interaction that goes on, and so there is the datagram that is sent from one endpoint to another, and so basically it's an asynchronous kind of communication. And it also works on top of the transport protocol UDP. So basically COPE, we have to keep in mind that COPE works on top of UDP. So this particular protocol is based on the IETF RESTful environment working group. So there is a REST architecture, RESTful architecture. And these people who have proposed the RESTful architecture, so they have proposed the COPE protocol. And so it is basically used sort of like a lightweight equivalent of the HTTP. And it's a standard REST. So REST basically, you know, so let us go back to the REST protocol first. So REST is a standard interface between the HTTP clients and servers. But this REST protocol is useful where there is no resource limitation, because, you know, this is quite resource hungry kind of protocol which consumes a lot of resources. REST basically is not good for constrained environments like IoT. So COPE is sort of like a sort of like an in protocol which is a lightweight equivalent of the REST architecture and REST protocol, and it helps to communicate with under low power constraints. So this is how COPE works. So as I was telling you, that it's a session layer protocol, or even we can think of it as a as an application layer protocol. So it basically works on top of the transport layer. So session layer or application layer are on top of the transport layer, and the transport layer protocol that is used in the context of COPE is the UDP. And so COPE basically has two main sub layers. One is the messaging sub layer, the other one is the request response sub layer, and I will show you pictorially how it looks like shortly. In summary, actually at a high level, we can think of the messaging sub layer to be responsible for functionalities such as reliability and duplication of avoidance of duplication of messages, while the request response sub layer is responsible for the communication, exact communication that is going to take place, the request being sent and the response being received. So, these are the two main sublayers that are there in the COAP protocol or the COAP architecture more specifically. So, there are different messaging modes for COAP. One is the confirmable mode, the second is the non-confirmable mode, the third is the piggyback mode and the fourth is the separate. So, as I was telling you, in the protocol stack, in terms of the layered architecture, COAP is a protocol of the session layer. Some can also think of it, you know, in some cases we try to avoid the session layer. So, in that case we can think of COAP to be merged with the application layer, but if session layer is considered, it is a protocol of the session layer. So, session layer means that it lies between the transport layer and the application layer. So, at the transport layer we have the UDP protocol and different applications being run in the application layer, and COAP basically sits in between. So, we have two sub layers, one is the request response, the other one is the messages. Messages is mostly concerned about the reliability, ensuring reliability of the network and reliability in communication, whereas request response is more to do with the exact communication in terms of sending a request and getting a response back. So, this is what I was mentioning earlier. So, we have different types of messages that are used in COAP. The first one is the confirmable message, the second is the non-confirmable message, the third is the piggyback message and the fourth is the separate message. So, basically when we look at COAP confirmable message, this is how it works. So, we have, so COAP is basically it is a connection between the client and the server in a resource constrained environment. So, what happens is a message is sent and an acknowledgement is received in the case of a confirmable message. So, this message basically, you know, it gets an acknowledgement back. So, it is a confirmable message. Then for a non-confirmable message, there is no acknowledgement from the server, and then we have the piggyback message, which is used for client server direct communication, where the server sends its response directly after receiving the message. So, that basically, you know, what happens is along with the acknowledgement message, the data is also sent, the response is also sent in the case of piggyback messages. And in the case of the separate mode, it is used when the server response comes in a message separate from the acknowledgement, and that basically may take some time to be sent to the server. This particular message might you know, because it is coming separate from the acknowledgement, it might take, you know, the acknowledgement might be received and the message might be received after a little while back. So, little while thereafter, I am sorry. And so, similar to HTTP, COAP basically utilizes different functionalities such as GET functionality, GET message, PUT message, PUSH message, DELETE message, etcetera. So, basically GET is for retrieval of some data, PUT is for creation. So, you want to put some data or some message into the repository. So, in that case PUSH or the server. So, in that case the PUT message is used, and then we have then we have the update for that, the PUSH is used, and the DELETE message is for deletion purpose. So, we have already looked at how the confirmable and the non-confirmable message request response looks like. So, let us now look at pictorially how the piggyback message request response model looks like. So, here basically as we can see, first a message is sent in piggyback. In contrast to the previous two models, that means the confirmable and the non-confirmable models, rather the confirmable model. So, what we have here as we can see, the data is basically piggybacked along with the acknowledgement, data is piggybacked along with the acknowledgement message. Okay. So, this is how the piggyback message request response model functions. Separate message, we have a message being sent, an acknowledgement being received, and there is a wait period after which the data is going to be sent separately from the server to the client. And corresponding to that, the client is going to send an acknowledgement back to the server. So, this is how separate messages look like. So, these basically COPE as a whole and these different message types, they together they help to reduce the overhead and the parsing complexity of the network. So, there are different types of discovery of resources that are supported by COPE, and we are going to go through them little bit further, so we now start with the XMPP protocol, which is the next protocol to be discussed. XMPP, the full form of XMPP is Extensible Messaging and Presence Protocol. So, it is a message oriented middleware that is based on XML. However, whereas XML is particularly used for unstructured data, XMPP is useful for real time exchange of structured data, and it is an open standard protocol. So, XMPP uses a client server architecture. It uses a decentralized model, meaning that there is no server that is involved in the message transfer, and it provides facilities for discovery of messages which are residing locally or globally across the network, and the availability information of these services. So, as we can now basically think about it, so it is well suited for cloud computing environments where virtual machines, networks and firewalls are involved and would otherwise present obstacles to the alternative service discovery and message based solutions. So, you know, think of it this way, that with the help of XMPP we can do things very similar to like the ping protocol. So, in the case of ping, basically, you know, when we have you know, the involvement of firewalls, etcetera, etcetera. So, ping cannot be used as such, right. So, in this particular case, in the case of XMPP, it basically removes all these constraints, these barriers for having the discovery of the services. And if it is the discovery of services locally, then it is no problem, but if it is across the network and there is a firewall in between, so XMPP can still work. So, some of these highlights of the XMPP protocol, it is based on the concept of decentralization, where there is no central server, and there, you know, everybody can run the XMPP server theoretically, and it is based on an open standard. So, there is no involvement of royalties or granting permissions to implement the XMPP specifications. Different security features, that the standard ones such as authentication, encryption, etcetera, can be implemented using XMPP, on top of XMPP rather, and XMPP also offers flexibility in terms of supporting interoperability between different systems, different devices, different protocols and so on. So, consequently, I was giving you the analogy with the traditional ping protocol that is used for internet, and here we are trying to have something similar, but you know, it is a bit different in this particular manner. So, it is, you know, if we look at this particular figure, what we see is with the help of XMPP, not only it is possible to communicate with other servers like in the case of the traditional internet, but also with other messaging platforms such as ICQ, AIM, Yahoo and so on. So, this is also possible. So, not only that, this is possible, this is also possible, But additionally, it is also possible to communicate with other intranets. So XMPP basically helps in doing this. There are few core XMPP technologies. One is the core technology which provides information about the core XMPP technologies for XML streaming. Then we have Jingle, which is used for multimedia signaling with the help of voice, you know, wherever there is multimedia resources such as voice, video, file transfer, etcetera, it can help in signaling Jingle. Multi-user chat, it is a flexible technology which can be used for multi-party communication. PubSub is publish subscribe model, and publish basically alerts, this PubSub model basically alerts and notifies for data syndication. And the BOSS technology, it is used for HTTP binding for XMPP. Wherever there is requirement for HTTP binding when using XMPP, this can be used. There are different weaknesses as well of XMPP protocol. It does not support QoS. Text based communication including you know, higher network overheads are involved in the use of XMPP. So, it is not good for text based communication, and binary data must be first encoded to base 64 before it can be transmitted. The different applications that use XMPP: publish subscribe systems, PubSub systems, then signaling for VoIP, video, file transfer, gaming applications, IoT applications such as smart grid, social networking, and so on. So, with this we have come to the end of two other protocols. We have discussed the two other protocols, and so XMPP is a protocol that is very useful. So, we have discussed about the COPE protocol first, which is a session layer protocol, which is useful for use in a similar kind of platform where REST is required for communication between the client and the server. So, COPE protocol, and then we have discussed about the XMPP protocol. Thank you.